Good morning once again. Welcome to The Breakfast on PLOS TV Africa. Our first major conversation this morning is moving across states. Of course, starting with Adamawa, where the people of Mubi and Chamba communities in Adamawa have, of course, requested for more states to be created. Not long ago also, there was conversations of Kaduna in Kaduna State, Southern and Northern Kaduna, asking for the splitting of the states into two. They have, of course, the committee handling the North-East Zonal public hearing for the review of the 1999 Constitution, and they have told them that there needs to be Amana and Gongola States. It is, like I said, similar to the request by some people in Kaduna State for the splitting of the state into Northern and Southern Kaduna. We, of course, have always known as about the request for an extra state in the Southeast to make up for the number of states and number of representatives that the Southeastern states have in the National Assembly. The big question is, of course, is does Nigeria need new states? And if yes, how many more? We're joined this morning by Mark Adebayo to discuss this. Good morning, Mr. Adebayo. Okay, we can't hear you. Good morning. Can you hear us? Okay, it seems your device is muted. We may have to, of course, ask if you can unmute your device so we can hear you clearly this morning.
Okay.
Fantastic. Okay, we can hear you now. Yes, we can. Good morning once again.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Good morning.
Thanks for joining.
Good morning.
All right. So it's a conversation that has come up in the past. In the Southeast earlier, there are people who had mentioned that the Southeast needed to create more states to meet up with the lack of numbers in the National Assembly and representatives. And of course, I had stated that it is unfair that certain regions in the country have as much as 7 states in those regions, but the Southeast has only 5. And now, of course, in Adamawa, there's a talk of Gongola states. Southern and Northern Kaduna have also been mentioned. So do you agree that Nigeria needs more states?
Well, you see, look, basically, let us go back to the fundamentals. Why the agitation for more states? There must be a reason for that, or there might be a set of reasons for that. You see, it is a sense of injustice, the sense of imbalance, the sense of marginalization in the country. These are the factors that are responsible for the agitation for more states. We have to face the reality. The current, even some of the states we have now, some of them are not viable. If not most of them, they are not viable.
Well, if you would say, I don't know if you can still hear us. We seem to have. Can you hear us, Mr. Adebayo? All right, go ahead. Go ahead.
For most states, is only that some people have been marginalized, or people have no sense of being cut out. And I think that is the major risk. Can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead.
So I think that is the major, those are the factors that are responsible for this clamor for more states, agitation for more states. If the people have a sense of belonging, if they have a sense of justice, nobody will be clamoring for more states. And I think at this point, there is something that the federal government and other states should go to Kogi State and learn. Because, you know, you discover that you are not hearing that kind of thing in the states anymore. 7 years ago, 8 years ago, you see a lot of communal clashes, intercommunal clashes, violence, and everything. So I don't know. There must be something that the current governor Yabilo is doing in that state that is making those agitations to go down, that is making insecurity in that state to go down. The constitution says the primary responsibility of every government shall be the welfare and security of the populace. And those two elements, whether you agree well with him or not, it is successfully being managed in Kogi State. And I think the federal government should go to that state and have at least one or two things about how to manage differences, about how to manage diversity, about how to bring everybody on board. There's a model in Kogi State that the federal government needs to go and learn about. And I really do not know how the crisis in that state was managed and reduced to a sense of, if they have a sense of belonging, if they have carried along, you understand me? They will not agitate for local government, states, and rest of that. I agree. On the issue of the Southeast, I really do not know what informed the fact that Southeast will have only 5 states. It is indefensible. There is no excuse for that. I really do not understand why the drafters of our constitution decided to allow Southeast to have only 5 states. It is indefensible. it is unreasonable. I mean, it is a direct assault of marginalization, and you are telling them they are second class or third class citizens in the country. It doesn't make sense. Set them aside for only 5 states. They have the right to agitate for more states. But yeah, I keep saying,
we'll get to the southeast and the part where you've mentioned, of course, people be feeling marginalized and unfairly treated. But you know, one thing you mentioned earlier was this fact that some states, you know, don't seem viable. A couple of states are not working. So would it make sense, seeing that there are certain states that don't seem to be working because, of course, of the system that we run, and after seeing that, you go ahead and create even more of these states?
That is why I'm saying that you are trying to solve a difficult situation, but we are going to create more crisis by having more states. But also, you know, it gives a sense of balance and belonging when people will still say, oh, I have my own state. We have our own state. You understand? If you are comfortable within your state, if you are comfortable within the Nigerian state itself, nobody will agitate for secession, nobody will agitate for statism, nobody will even agitate for restructuring. It is the acute sense of injustice and lack of belonging, you know, the lack of the sense of belonging in the country that is leading to all these agitations. That is why the next president must be somebody who can demonstrably unite the country. You know, our diversity should not be our adversity. It should be our advantage. But we don't have the managers, the good managers of our diversity in the country now. And that is why Kogi State holds the best model for the management of diversity in this country today. That model is needed at the presidency. It's needed at the presidential level. We should not think that we can solve every problem by using sledgehammer to kill a fly. There must be an intelligent political management of society. That is what can give us the kind of peace, progress, and just and unity and unison, to speak in unison, that we need in this country. You understand me? No. Other states, even states where people are clamoring for states, if those states have, you know, just demonstrated justice to all, fairness to all, under their state, nobody will be clamoring for state. Under that state, you understand me? So, and the same thing with the federal government. Okay. People are clamoring for all manner of things that is because of the lack of sense of justice for everybody. There's no balance. That's why I keep mentioning the Kogi model.
Okay. So, Mr. Adebayo, can you hear me?
I'm hearing you loud and clear.
How about the perspective, you know, that breaking out more states would further divide the country?
Yeah. You see, I keep saying that you want to solve a problem, we are going to create more complications. You understand? In the current 36 state structure, it is so difficult for people to even manage their states. We cannot have states who depend 90% on the federal government to survive. No, that is a fundamental index of unviability. But people are, I keep saying, let us go to the factor, to the reason. Why are they clamoring for it? It may not be viable, it may not even run successfully, but they want their own states, where they can feel a sense of belonging, where they can feel carried along. But if you have a government, a system that operates on the basis of fairness, on the basis of equity, nobody will want to agitate for one state or agitate for even their own country.
All right, Mr. Adebayo.
You know, seven years ago, Kogi State is a place that I know considerably. There were intercommunal clashes, there were agitations for local government, there were agitations even for separate states. People are just fighting over little things and rest of that. So that then this governor came in and resolved those problems. I think we should go and borrow a model from that state to see how the governor managed to manage all these diversities and crises and confusion and bring everybody on board. And that is why, you see, when you bring on board traditional rulers, youth, women, everybody in the state to the table, you know, where you don't say, I want to hold a security meeting, I want to hold a stakeholder meeting, only the traditional rulers will come, only select politicians will come. But you bring everybody on board, there will be peace as you are witnessing today in Kogi State. There will be harmony as you are witnessing today in Kogi State. You know, so that is why I keep saying that the presidency needs the Kogi model. And we need to, so that you can dial the agitation, the fear of the people, the trepidation that, look, we are going to be annihilated if we don't have our own country, if we don't have our own state. The states, for now, are struggling. The Edo State governor came out publicly to say that the federal government had to print more money to be able to settle them for April or March. You cannot be doing that. You are inviting hyperinflation. So, more state is not the solution, really, sincerely speaking.
All right.
Practically speaking, more state is not the solution. It is not, because it's going to create more confusion and crisis for us. We will not be able to find the financial capacity to be able to manage.
Okay, so then how
the federal government should seriously consider the agitation for restructuring. Without restructuring, the country will rupture, and we have to run away from that. Nobody loses this in the restructuring system. You have to, if you restructure the system and you allow the state to substantially control their own resources, control their own fate, control their own destiny, control their own security, 100%. You know, that will be, you know, people will find a way to make their state work. So in the structure of Nigeria, most states may work, but at the current structure, most states will not work. It will kill, it will create more chaos and crisis. Even the people that will get the state will regret getting the state. We have to face the reality.
So, Mr. Adebayo, you're basically saying that restructuring is the solution. You mean it's a bit like the win-win answer to all the agitations we're seeing. But we've been talking about restructuring for a long time coming. How long more do you think we'll need to talk about this before restructuring and devolution of power becomes a reality? Do we need to wait for another government, another, you know, 8 years?
It is the responsibility of the citizens to ask. It is the responsibility of the government to give. If we are not getting restructuring now, it is because the federal government is not listening to the demands of the citizenry. We have been asking for restructuring. If the government had listened to us, well, we have been clamoring for restructuring for 15 years. Nobody will come out today and be asking for Oduduwa. Nobody will come out today and be asking for Biafra. Nobody will coming out today to ask for a new master in all those things. But because there was no... The power that be refused to listen to the clamor for restructuring. Let's go back to 1963 constitution and even improve on that, because the 63 constitution cannot even go far enough to satisfy the yearnings and aspirations of the people of Nigeria today. Nobody loses anything. Why are some people so much afraid of restructuring? What is the meaning of this elementary meaning of restructuring is that you allow federated units to have substantial control of their socio-political and economic destinies. Why should everybody be afraid of that? You know, you control your economy, you control your resources, you donate like maybe 5 or 10% to the center to that can run, but you allow the state to determine substantially how they run their security, how they run their education, how they run their... The concurrent list is not robust enough. The exclusive list has totally taken out the advantages in the concurrent list. Now, you cannot have a country that is operating like that. You cannot operate a feeding bottle structure whereby the state will have to come to Abuja every month, cap in hand, to collect money. No, allocation of resources cannot be, you know, concentrated in one unit at the center of a country as large, as big, as diverse as Nigeria. Powers that be, the ruling cliques, must begin to think sincerely and very seriously about the structure in this country, to doubt this tension, to doubt this tension. Now, you see, at the state level, let me give you an instance. At the state level, you know, the judiciary is clamoring for autonomy, the local governments are clamoring for autonomy, and at those levels, and then those states are also clamoring, you know, clamoring for restructuring at the federal government level. What we should do is that even the states, the governors, who are also clamoring for restructuring, should start and begin to restructure their states. Let me give you an instance. In a couple of states, you know, like Kogi, and I think Rivers too, and I think there's another state I'm trying to remember. We are in the states.
All right, Mark Adebayo, can you hear us?
I am absolutely 100% sure of the Kogi state, because I'm from Kogi state. I'm not from Kogi. So I'm hearing you. So we have to borrow a model there where the governor has succeeded in restructuring the state, give the usual economy, local government economy, and let us try that in our state, and then put pressure on the federal government to restructure the state. It does not take Mr. President anything to listen to the clamor for restructuring. If you agree to restructuring, the clamor for secession will go down. In fact, we go down with peaceful heart.
All right, hold on, Mark Adebayo.
A child is crying for biscuits. You are giving him blanket. You understand? He will throw away the blanket. He will throw it away and smash it and scatter it.
Oh, so, all right, Ms. Adebayo, hold on. Hold on.
The biscuit that the squire is asking for.
Well, before you know, we start sharing bean cakes. Let's you know, go back a little bit. A lot of times we speak about, you know, injustice and unfairness, and you know, not being able to pull people together, and some of all of that on the federal level. But it's pretty obvious that there's a lot of all those things still happening on the state level that has created these call for, you know, new states. In Kaduna, for example, there, you know, seems to have been this long issues between, you know, Northern and Southern Kaduna. And Southern Kaduna people have always felt marginalized or felt, you know, unfairly treated. So how do you respond, you know, to the fact that it's not just on the federal level, but even on the state level, we seem to have that same culture of injustice and unfairness?
Well, the Kaduna State is a particular, exemplary, tragic situation. You know, the kind of experience that Zata Kaduna people have been going through for decades, not just under this governor, for decades, is unimaginable. It is unacceptable. There have been victims of organized genocide. It is unfortunate. It is tragic. I don't know, and unfortunately, even the current governor, you know, also puts fuel in the fire. His body language, his focal language, are not consistent with a leader that wants peace. You know something? If I should meet Governor Elrufai today, I would just advise him to take a stroll. Just go to Kogi State, not far from you. Go and learn how Governor Yayabelo was able to manage to doubt the crisis in the state. You should just go there. You understand? You know, I cannot understand. You know, there was a time the Southern Kaduna people were more or less tagged as terrorists by the governor of the state. People that you are supposed to call to a round table and discuss with, you are tagging them. You are tagging the Sokapo. Kaduna people's union, you're attacking them as terrorists. That was the same mistake the federal government made when they attacked IPOM. IPOM was just protesting. It was not armed by then. But they attacked them terrorists. And what did they do? They started behaving like terrorists. You understand? And can you blame them? You know, people are saying this is the part of the injustice we are talking about. By the time that IPOM was not carrying arms, you attacked them terrorists. But you refused to attack killer others terrorists. It is part of the things that people are seeing. And it's unfortunate that, you see, that is why I plead. The Nigerian populace, the Nigerian electorate, must determine now that is the time that they need a young, educated, vibrant, energetic president come 2023. Nobody should go, don't vote for money, don't vote for anything, don't vote for ethnicity, don't vote for religion. Let us go for an experienced, young, vibrant, educated, energetic young person who will be able to manage the crisis of this country, who will have the power, the strength, the energy, the intellect, the intelligence to be able to carry the weight of this country. Septuagenarians and octogenarians cannot carry the weight of this country. They cannot. So we have seen the experience now. And anybody, you know, the septuagenarians, octogenarians who are clamoring to become president in 2023, Nigerians should massively ignore them in whatever political party. Let us work together, any of the young people, the viable young people that come on board to say that I want to be president. Let us back them up. Let us back them up. You understand? You know, some of them are coming up. We have Mogalu, who says he wants to try again. And we have We have Governor Abeloso, who said that he wants to, this is 45 years old, 40 something people. That those are the people who can carry the load of those country now. It is, look, we can no longer go back what do you call it? This is digital age, you know. Analog, we cannot use analog age to solve the problem of a digital age. And that is one of the problems we are having with the current administration. I stand on my point on that. With age, in other countries, like maybe US, you have a president that's above 70, fine. It is working for them. It is not because they have a political system that supports, you know, excellence in everything. Excellence. If you are able to give delivery, they will vote for you. It's not only in Nigeria that we have a 70-something-year-old president. But in other states, in other countries, they have people who are older than that, but who are also performing. But it seems it is a major factor here. We need people who are between 35 and 45, 46, people who are not yet 50 to become president come 2023. And Nigeria should be on the lookout. I see those of us, especially those who have had experience in managing, maybe as governors, maybe as whatever, maybe as senators, who have been involved in the management of the country at one level or the other. But who are still less than 50, who are still less than 60. Anybody above 60 has no business contesting for election 2023 at any level, especially at the presidential level. No. And some of us are going to mobilize Nigerians in favor of the younger generation. It is your generation now that will take over this country and use your intelligence and use your capacity and use your education.
Well, there's obviously...
We don't want people who are complicating matters.
Yeah, there's obviously a lot of...
is complicating matters. We cannot continue with that in 2023. Nigerians should take note. And youth and women are 73% of the electorate. Let them go and give us a young president.
All right, hold on, please. There's obviously, you know, a couple of factors that need to come into play for that to be possible. You know, also with fixing our electoral system, and some of all those aspects, the electoral bill still needs to be signed before we, you know, can find those possibilities. INEC, of course, has continued to struggle with getting eligible voters registered and getting their voters' cards to them for the longest time. But I want to go back to your thoughts on restructuring. There is people who would say that the reason why, or the reason we've struggled with being able to achieve, you know, an actual conversation on restructuring and steps, genuine steps towards restructuring, is because certain regions don't feel like they will be able to survive by themselves if Nigeria restructures. Can you hear me?
I'm hearing you now.
Okay.
So basically, you see, look. I had part of your question, but I don't think there's a constitutional lacuna or constitutional, inhibition on the part of the young people to contest. You understand me? And that is why, we have the Not Too Young to Run Act, which has substantially reduced the age of people who can contest. People in their 20s now can contest. And I think from 30 or so, that protest for the presidency. So you don't need to do anything in the area of age, in the electoral act again, to allow young people like you to run for the presidency. No, one thing that, aside from education, you need, I keep saying, you need experience in political management, whether at local government level, whether at the national, at state level, whether at the national level, and some other or corporate experience in the management of people and resources. That is it. So, and that is why I've mentioned two people to you. I've mentioned Governor Yayabido, I've mentioned Mogadu to you. These are still the people in the younger generation of political, of the political trajectory of Nigeria. And we have to be able, I know that Mogadu is considered as a person, as a person. But I also know that in the management of people, of crisis, Yabelo has succeeded in the state to a large extent. I keep referring to the Kogi model because of what he has been able to demonstrate at that level. So, there will not be shortage of young people to vote for. Blackmail of what can we do, this and that. And the youth, some of them will say, go around, they will say they don't have the money, they don't have the resources, you understand? But let them come together and support one of their own. and support one of their own.
Well, you know, it's not. What I was saying is, it's not because, you know, there's no space for young people to contest. There's definitely, but the cost of running elections in Nigeria, you know, is a challenge. The cost of running, you know, for office in Nigeria is a challenge. There's also, you know, like I mentioned, the factors concerning INEC as a body, you know, that has made it difficult for these young people that you've mentioned, and the women, and the, you know, the vast number of Nigeria's population, to really get themselves in a you know, place to get registered, get their voters card and vote. You know, so those are some of the things that I was talking about that need to be fixed. And of course, the electoral bill that still has not been signed. I asked a question with regards restructuring and the perspective that some people have, that the reason we might not be able to do that, or why it has not been achieved yet, is because there are certain regions that feel they may not survive a restructured Nigeria. Do you, you know, agree with those people? And do you think that regardless of what they think, we should go ahead and restructure and they would fall in line eventually?
Well, you know, everything boils down to leadership. And the biggest albatross of this country has been leadership failure. If we had the right leadership, nobody would be afraid of anything. Nobody would be suspicious of any step. Imagine, overwhelming number of Nigerians, especially in the South, are clamoring for restructuring. Yes, some people are also afraid. Not even the government now, not even the political cliques now, not even the political class now. Some people are afraid of restructuring Nigeria. Let me give you an instance. During the 2014 National Conference under Jonathan, most of the Southern delegates were clamoring for restructuring. The minority elements in the North objected to it. They objected to it vehemently. They said, no, if you restructure Nigeria, will be left at the mercy of the majority in the North. No, they did not want to support it. They had to be cajoled, they had to be convinced that the restructure Nigeria will work for everybody. So, genuine fears are there, even for restructure Nigeria. I agree with that. But, you know, leadership, if you get our leadership right, if you get the right leader, the right president at the center, who can bring everybody together, who can unite the people, who can listen to people, you know, we will not be having all these agitations, sincerely speaking, we will not be having all these fears. Now, you are talking about the electoral system, vis-a-vis INEC's incapacity in terms of management of our elections. I agree with you. But that should not discourage anybody from making effort to contest. And that is why the young...
Okay, we might have lost him there, but he was wrapping up. Mr. Adebayo, all right. We apologize for the network glitch there, but thank you very much. Your thoughts are well noted regarding this particular issue. And about the National Confab, yes, they recommended 19 states, you know, to be created to add, you know, to the states in Nigeria. But, you know, we still haven't gotten to the end of that discussion regarding all the other recommendations of the National Confab. Yep. But yes, this is still an ongoing conversation. Many more states or many more groups might still make their own claim or their own case for state creation. But we'll see how it goes, though. We'll take a break here to bring updates on a topic we covered the last time about a man who was wrongfully arrested when he came into Imo State for his father-in-law's burial. There's an update on that story regarding his release after the break.